Tommy, we've often chatted about forgotten boxers, you know, names lost in the history books and memories of a generation been and gone. We're going to start this series with a few names who you remember well. I mean, you're 80 years old now, Tommy, and some of the people we're going to speak about, you actually seen them fight live. We're going to bring alive some of these box rec pages of pugilists from a bygone age, you know, often never viewed or remembered. Okay, the first one, Tommy, is Artie Town. We've spoke about him a few times, but never on a video or on or anything like when we've, you know, when we have our chats. Artie Town is a name that often comes up in your discussions. Now, a little before you tell us about him, just a brief synopsis of him. In 1955, Artie arrived in Liverpool from New York and not only shook up Liverpool boxing, but British boxing. He became an instant hero in the UK and you know, like I say, a name that is not often remembered or spoke about, but a man who had a big impact. Tommy, Artie Town, tell us about the man and what he became here in the UK.
Well, when Artie Town come to this country, Artie Town was what people then called a policeman. By that, I mean, today, a contender, and sometimes they call him a gatekeeper. To beat them, you've got to be any good. Now, but what I'm saying to you is this, Artie Town today, with the governing bodies it is and the sanctioning bodies, would have definitely been a world champion today. Apparently, they say that the management of Sugar Ray Robinson had something to do with Artie. You know, I don't know. But what I do know is this, he's a fantastic fighter. And, I mean, I'm going back when I was about 15 or 16. Old Fred Tilson, who boxed in America, Chester. I mean, Fred was no top to bill at the old Pudgy Street Stadium and everything when he was 17, 15 rounds. Well, he was a local hero, and he heard about Artie Town coming over here, and he was something special. I went to see him train, or he met him, and I went with him, and somebody said he was going to be fighting Willie Armstrong, a tough boy from Port Glasgow. He's got his middleweight champion, been with him all, and there's not money he hadn't done, like, you know. And Artie says it to yourself, and the fella said, oh, he's one tough fella, and this and the other. And old Fred just turned around and said, he asked if he was a southpaw. And Artie Town smiled and said, you know your boxing. He said, I should. They were fought over in your country. And the next thing he talked, anyhow, I don't think Fred ended up with two tickets because he took me to see him fight the stadium. And, Willie Armstrong, he got stopped in the second round. It was someone else. The crowd just couldn't believe it. Artie Town was a hero overnight. The next time out, he fights Johnny Sullivan, the British champion. That was that was a month later, 3 weeks later. Johnny Sullivan, as tough as he was, and he fought in the States himself. And Johnny Sullivan, he had a record, a good record. There's no getting away from it. 52 wins and only 3 defeats. He wasn't in the ring a minute before he was bang. I think there was 2 counts of 8, so 1 and 9, and Sparko, the referee, stopped it. Now, when you can put guys like that to sleep. And years later, I asked when I was in Gleason's gym about Artie Town, you know, like, and Al Gavin, the legendary cutman Al Gavin, told me that he was the fastest combination puncher he'd ever seen. But there's an interesting story about Artie Town. that Gus D'Amato had him when Patterson was on his way up. And then, for some unknown reason, he thought he defended his title against Jeremiah Johansson. There was a bit of a fallout, and Whitey Brinstein, who was training Johansson for the fight, found out, and he called in Artie Town. He was sparring and this, that, and the other. You believe me, he might have only been a middleweight, but he could go in with anybody, Artie Town. And I'll tell you one thing. What happened? Johansson was a new champion. But next time around, Artie Town was back with Patterson. That's what I heard. And the first person to go the distance at Artie Town in this country, it happened at Bellevue, was Les Allen. Now, Les Allen was a very, very, from Bedworth in the Midlands, was one very good boxer. Now, you're talking about, there was a glut of talent there in around Britain at that time. I don't think, it's only years later that we appreciate the talent that was around. There was Johnny Sullivan, Billy Elloway, Cloud Pleasers. It was Pat McAteer, Les Allen, Gordon Hazel, and of course, the one, the daddy, you know, prior to that, the legendary Randolph Turpin. Now, you're talking about talents, and each one of them had to be on, to beat the other would have to be on the best night they'd ever had. Now, Artie Town, for Les Allen to go the distance with Artie Town, you believe me, that was something. Because in his last fight in Britain, a man who fought Archie Moore twice for the light heavyweight title, the world title, Yvonne Durrell, got disqualified with Artie Town. He didn't want to know, and Eatman, you believe me, Yvonne Durrell was one tough hombre, but he knew that he was coming unstuck with Artie Town. Artie Town, he was a very, very avoided fighter. I honestly think that I wonder if he had any regrets by not permanently stopping in England. I just don't know. But he was a brilliant fighter, and I think he was avoided. He was too good for his own good. There's a lot of people like that, you know. I mean, even his last fight was against a man from Peru who was a contender for the world light heavyweight title, Mario Mina. And, you know, like, people like that. I mean, that was his last fight. He'd had a break of about 3 years and maybe needed a few bob, I don't know. But he was absolutely brilliant. You know, I mean, fighters like that, today he would have been a world champion.
No doubt about it. 113 fights, Tommy. 94 wins, 43 knockouts. He'd lost 16 and drawn one. A couple of them losses were late in his career, like you say, when he was way past it. But he'd had a like you say, a huge career in America before coming over to Liverpool.
Oh, yes.
In 1955. But it was never recognised like that, was he? I mean, he got
no. You see, yeah. Unfortunately, this is the tragedy of it. The likes of these people, they fought men with winning records all the time. And they weren't recognised for what they were. Honestly, it's unbelievable that their record is, some of the people that they fought, the men that they fought, and the regular way they fought, it must have been heartbreaking for them not to get the opportunities that you had.
To think he never held a world title with the people he fought.
I mean, it's a tragedy. I mean, for an instant, look at Jersey Joe Walcott. For years, all right, he fought Joe Louis twice and everything like that. But for years, there he was, avoided. He had to fight when he wanted. He had kids and everything like that, and all that. And he was thinking of packing it all in. And it was Christmas. And Felix Pacheco turned up at his house with all the fare he needs for Christmas and a ton of coal to keep him warm. Jersey Joe, give him one more crack with Felix Pacheco, his manager. He won the world title. But I'll tell you straight now, how many great fighters never got the chance to wear the purple of champion? Harty Town was one. How long did Sugar Ray Robinson have to wait before he fought for the welterweight title, the great of the world? And he was number one contender for years. You know, it's unbelievable what went on. Don't you believe that the best always fought the best? Sometimes the best did want to fight the best, but it was managers and promoters that stopped that.
I know what your thoughts on Sugar Ray Robinson, as my own are. He's, you know, definitely the best. Arty Town was part of Robinson's famous entourage, wasn't he? He was part.
That's
of,
right. You know, yes.
Like you've already
look,
met. So
you
would have
you
been
look
hard with him and been around him. You know. He
yeah. This is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
In a way, Arty Town was like Ray Robinson, policeman. You see what I mean? That's what you used to call them.
And you met him, Tom. You met Arty. Fred took you to meet him. So you met him when he was over here, like I say, before that fight. And it's amazing to think that he was at that fight, the one he had with the Scottish champion. Like you say, he was actually at that fight.
Oh, another thing is this, that nobody knew at the time, but Georgie, George Dingley, who was Johnny Sullivan's manager, collapsed at the ringside when Sullivan got stopped, and he died of a heart attack later.
Right.
I don't know whether seeing Sullivan hit the floor and get knocked out had something to do with that, but that's what happened.
Wow. Yeah.
I never seen him collapse in the ringside like or anything like that, but that's what did happen.
What was the atmosphere like? I mean, that was we're talking like
William Armstrong, your atmosphere,
here, and then he fought Sullivan. So you had both of them fights, Tommy, at Liverpool Stadium. Was you at both of them fights, Artie's first two fights in the UK?
No, I've seen Willie Armstrong. The atmosphere. Now, this is something else that used to happen in Liverpool. It happened all over the Manchester and everywhere, at the Free Trade Hall and all the venues. You see, you're talking about a different era of people. Now, you didn't need security around the ringside then with these. You see, these people, if you look at it, like my father's generation and this, who used to take you, they had had it rough before the war. They'd had it serve the country and come back, those that did. When they went to a thing, when they went to a sporting do, they went to enjoy themselves. And I'll tell you now, you'd see the opponent get an ovation just the same as the local hero. No getting away from it. Now, another thing was this. They went there to enjoy themselves. And nothing was going to upset them. And they'd be there before the first bout, and that place would nearly be full. And the anticipation, the atmosphere was even I'll be quite honest with you now, with getting, I'm seeing that sort of atmosphere come back in the small hall shows, the Blackfast and promotions, what I've seen at the VIP promotions, and Joe Gallagher's promotion, the first one I went to, and the one in Liverpool, the Red Triangle Dome, now with Pat Barrett, because you could sense the atmosphere there, and that's how it was. Now, at Liverpool Stadium, you'd see the place nearly full before the first bout. And, you know, actually, it was a lovely, friendly atmosphere. As if we're here to enjoy ourselves. And it was the same with the football matches. When they heard about Celtic and Rangers fans kicking off, we used to think everybody was a nutter. Now, you know, I mean, I'll be quite honest with you, it was unbelievable, the atmosphere. And as soon as you saw Ardy Town getting that ring that night, you knew it was something special.
He had that star quality.
Oh, yeah, you know, there was the charisma there. You know, you knew, as soon as you seen, it was, you know, you can't explain it, but it's when you see somebody for the first time and something clicks, you knew the way his movement, you know, you thought this fella is something. I mean, I'll be quite honest with you, if ever you've done a bit or anybody's ever done a bit, you know, you never judge a boot by the cover. You know that guy can give you trouble. Now, I'll tell you, before I forget about this, you know what I told you about that man who set traps around the allotment? Right? I've asked him if he'll tell you about it. When you do an interview with Nishi Domi, he said yes. But there's another story I want him to tell you about when he'd done a job for a man who's a relation of mine. And he's a good builder and everything. And he said, meet me in the mouth for your money, the pub. They went to the mouth. He said, you'll have to wait. He said, I'll put your wages on the racehorse. The racehorse went in at 6-1. He got 7 weeks' money. But you'll have to hear it from his own ears, his own mouth. It's a good one. No, but when you saw Ardy Town that night, you knew it was something special, and he was.
And you said, sorry,
Tom, go on. You see, how can you put it? Now, it's just the same with Larry Baker and Dees. But once you've seen, if you can, I was 16, 1955, I mean, no, 15, yeah? The year I started work, yeah? And what I'm saying to you is this, that if you can still see that fight is in your mind's eye, and you see Larry Baker in your mind's eye, you know, it shows you, you know, just how great they were.
Yeah. You've often
said, you know, people
became an hero, Ardy Town.
Pardon?
You said Ardy Town became a hero here, very well revered, you know.
Oh, I'll tell you this, not just, I mean, the people, you know, they were stopping in the street, he could have gone to somewhere, and no, because people were stopping him, he was letting people take photos, well, if they could get a camera, they're signing autographs with everybody. He's a lovely fella. Oh, that reminded me of Chris Eubanks, something about being a gentleman in the boxing news this week. Well, I don't think a gentleman would have refused to sign my grandson's autograph, Luke. But there again, I know Artie Town wouldn't. If he'd have still been around, put it that way.
But yeah, he got the adulation that he never got in the US, didn't he?
He did. Honestly, looking back, if he was to see things that happen today with the likes of Matchroom with Eddie Earn and with Frank Warren and that, they'd have had him over here and they'd have got him a world title. He was something else.
No doubt about it.
Another interesting one, Tommy. We're going to move on. And I'm sure we'll touch on Artie Town's career again as well, because there's probably a lot of meat to put on the bone there as well. Jimmy King, again, another one who we've spoken
now,
about.
Now, Jimmy King.
Fighter.
Now, Jimmy King, he was another one. What you've got to look at with Jimmy King is this. That his first repeat, I think, was against Harvey Town. And Harvey Town was 54-1 at the time. And to lose the decision. Now, his record is lettered with contenders. I think he had about 40 fights before he fought anybody with a losing record, and then the fella had an even record. You know, I mean,
unbelievable.
Okay, they're bringing the boys on. I agree with that up to a point, but look, in his fourth fight, his third fight, I can tell her. He's got a record of 27 wins and 3 losses right the way through. Some of the names on the record, Bobby Lake, these fellas, they're not good lads in the first year. You know, I mean, you're talking about 2 years, just over 2 years after fighting. Starting as a pro, he's fighting Artie Town. I mean, and these fellas, if you've seen them in the street, they'd hardly have a mark on them. You know, I mean, they were good defensive fighters and they fought the best. You know, it makes you think, you know, just what's going on. I mean, there was some of the names on the record, I mean, they mean nothing today, but years ago, there was a Chico Verona, Bobby Lee, you know, Don Ellis, another class act. Now, all right, they've got, he wasn't even a heavy middleweight. He wasn't even a heavy welterweight, Jimmy King. But then he was like heavyweight, and more than hell, he don't.
He fought like Yolande Pompey.
I mean, Artie Town, 54 when he fights. As he in 48, he turned pro in 46, so. I mean, it just shows you.
He beat someone that you often talk about, well, Wally Tom. He beat him in Streatham before fighting.
Him.
He beat Wally Tom, who you often speak about, who you knew.
Yeah, well, I mean, you have a look. Wally Tom was British and European champion, right? He fought, I mean, you're talking about, they fought the national champions. He had 25 fights out of his 78 fights, and he was third in his career in Europe. It just shows you what a crowd pleaser and popular fighter he was.
Yeah.
Because they were virtually more or less classed as local heroes. I mean, they were fighting, these people were fighting the national champions in their own backyard. Now, these people, you know, what you've got to look at, you're talking about a different era, aren't you?
Absolutely,
yeah. I mean, you have a look. Now, and I believe a lot of it has to do with when they come over to Europe, and seen the way they were treated, because segregation. Ralph DePaz from New Orleans, he was trained. He was trained by Angelo Dundee. He fought Joe Brown for the lightweight championship of the world. He got beat. After he fought Joe Brown, he couldn't fight in Louisiana because they said that he wasn't bouts between colored and whites wasn't supposed to take place. And then they said that the paths were colored. Now, look, never mind what we say about democracies. This country, they've got enough to do with it over the Windrush scandal. I mean, I know what I'm talking about here because my father went away down to Kentish Town to work, and the person he put with him as his fittest mate was a coloured boy from British Guiana called Julian. The tea break came, and Julian said, come on, Julian. He said, I can't go. He said, your dad said, you're my mate, he said, and he was me. Somebody objected, and things got a bit out of order, and the old fella stuck one on him. Now then, what I am saying to you is this. I know a little bit about the travelling around like I did on the furnaces and in the gasworks and places like that. On the retort, I worked with a lot of us from Manchester, from Salford and everywhere. And I'll be quite honest with you now. Some of the jobs that these lads come over, when we went to do the shutdowns, they had the jobs that couldn't be supplied, that a lot of our own people didn't want. Now, another thing about this, we couldn't get them over quick enough when the war was on. A lot of the, hadn't they been for the Commonwealth? And we'd have still been under a Nazi jackboot, or the German jackboot, because the Nazis were Germans. And never mind, you're not supposed to say these things. Let's have it right. The way that generation, after coming over here to fill the workplace, and the way they were treated with the Windrush scandal was disgusting. And it doesn't do well for the politicians in this country. I'm very sorry over that. I shouldn't, you might say, this isn't to do with boxing, but this has a lot to do with it, because I feel bad that Joe Bygraves was never able to fight for the British title. Though he was born in Jamaica, and no years later it's been altered. But Joe Bygraves, in my opinion, that spoilt his earning power. Great fighter as he was and everything like that, he beat Henry Cooper twice. He should have had a chance on. You know, things like that, they do get to me. Jimmy King was an exceptional fighter. You believe me. And he was only, how can I put it this way? At the end of the line, when he went back to America, you can understand him going back home. It's helping him have a good career in Europe. When he fought a man in Oakland, California called Charlie Tombstone Smith. Now, Charlie Tombstone Smith, you all said, was heading for the big time. His nickname was Tombstone because he put that many people to sleep. But then the Ellis was there. He was still there. able to give him all he wanted. You believe me, some fighter.
Yeah.
You believe me. When you see, if you saw these people in the street, they were always immaculately dressed. They always looked the part. And this is what makes me, I mean, really, you only have to look. It's when I was with Peter Fiore. Peter remarked on how it's turned out. And I said to Peter, yes, but you're in your working clothes. But Peter still looked immaculate to me because he was in the place where that is. Now, this is the beauty of the ordinary person over the politician. The ordinary person can put a suit on and look the business. He can be in his working muck and still look the business because he's an ordinary man, a working man. And he can put his casual clothes on and still look the part because he's not acting. Do these politicians realise how foolish they look when they try to look like us? Because they're only playing at it and they're acting. That's what I'm talking about. In my opinion, the ordinary person can look the part wherever he is. Artie Town looked the part when he was walking down the street. And when he got in the ring, he looked the part. And you believe me, him and Jimmy King, they wear the part. I believe he should have stopped over here. He loved him. But then again, maybe he had his family in America, didn't he? You know, I mean, I believe that Auntie Town was, and the same with Jimmy King, they were loved. And, you know, Lonny Baker, you have to see it at Liverpool. The crowd would be on the feet when he saw Lonny Baker after knocking out the local hero in one run when he was walking into the making his way to the ring when he fought the others over here, the crowd would be on the face. They loved him.
Yeah. There's a lot of boxers, Tommy, who came here in the 50s. There was still a lot of American army bases here, wasn't there? So a lot of them were.
Yes.
I'm not sure if Jimmy King or Artie Town were, but there was a lot of boxers. Like say stationed here, from who had boxed before the war and that kind of thing. You know, we were probably relatively unknown, like Artie Town, until he got in the ring and they realised he'd had bloody don't know how many fights before the war kind of thing. But these were experienced boxers. But that's what.
But I believe now.
You come over here, Tommy. Getting over it.
Baby Gay has got me beat because. He turned professional, if you look at his record, in Italy. If you look at his record, he turned professional in Italy. Now, he had 35 or 50 fights in Italy, and he fought.
France, wasn't it, Tommy? He fought in France, Sweden, Germany.
You see... He had 35 fights in Europe before he went back to America. Now, was he a serviceman who boxed in the services? You see, in those days, if you was in the American services, you had to wear head guards when you boxed in case you got injured. Now, this is true. You don't know whether he boxed over there... I don't know whether he boxed in the services as an amateur and everything, and then decided he turned professionally in because he liked it over here, you know, in Italy or in Europe. But, I mean, it's unbelievable. You've got an American that is virtually
We were going to move on to him, weren't we, Baby Day? But he lost his first
one, two, three, four, five fights. His first five fights. Well, his first three were in France, Tommy, and then his next three were in Gothenburg.
Yeah.
And then he went back to France. Then he between France and Gothenburg, and then like four fights in Germany.
Yeah.
It was what a funny career. That he fought at Earl's Court then as well. He had a couple of fights there.
You see, if you look at it,
Dick Turpin, Rambo's brother.
Beat
Turpin.
What you've got to look at with this, just imagine, you've got these lads are strangers in another country, and for them to get accepted like they are and like they were, and to get the work they've done, it just shows you how good they must have been. There's another one called Bobby Dawson. I mean, these fellas, they were really something. I mean, you take Jimmy King. I mean, he fought with Turpin, didn't he? And, you know, these sort of people, I mean, what I'm talking about is Turpin had a winning record. You know, they didn't care who they fought, they, as long as they were in that ring and earning money.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at some of the men on the record, they fought people with winning records. They wasn't saying, oh, I'm not having him or anything like that. They had confidence in their own ability to look after themselves with the best. And they did. There's no getting away from it. I mean, Larry Baker, there was a man who fought Emil Griffith for the world welterweight title. Larry Baker beat him, called Gaspar Ortega, a Mexican. Now, he was a good performer. Now, Larry Baker beat him. He got to be number 7 in the world at one time, Larry Baker. He come over here when they thought he was finished. He put away Tony Smith. But fair play to Tony Smith. His next fight was a return with Larry Baker, and he beat Larry Baker on points. And then what a fight that was. Then Larry Baker, in my opinion, Jimmy McGrail, I thought a lot of him, but Larry Baker was robbed against Jimmy McGrail. And when he fought Mick Lee, what a fight that was. That was his last fight in this at Liverpool before he went back to America. You know, he come over and he went, and what an ovation he got at the end. He thanked the Liverpool crowd for the way he'd been received. He said, I came as a stranger and I became a local. And the crowd rose to him. What a lovely man. I mean, when you saw the likes of them, and Mick Lee was the same, from Cork. What a beautiful boxer he was. And he'd fight anybody. He was an Irishman from County Cork, and he wasn't allowed to fight for a British title, but he was working over at Coventry. He was paying his taxes over here, and there was going to be a march to London to the Houses of Parliament, and people in Liverpool were going to take part in it to get him a British title fight. He did get one in the end he got stopped, but he was having difficulty making the weight against Brian Curvis. But he won the British middleweight title afterwards. Wonderful, wonderful fighter.
Yeah.
Mick Lee. But, you know, like people like that. I mean, John McCormack and his brother from Dublin, who I've met on many occasions, and Pat McCormack, there was, they got national, they won the British title. Their father was the legendary Spike McCormack. who's their cousin used to train the Corinthians in Dublin. They were great, great people, great boxing family. The lovely memories I've got with meeting these people, you know. Now, you see, what it was, a lot of them also was Air Force bases. Like, there was one at Burton Wood, Warrington. That was a very big one. At Sealand, at Chester, there was American servicemen there. Now, you see, this was into the 50s, and I remember these things going over because with Fred Tilson boxing over there in the States, I don't know how he was, but you'd get the American servicemen coming into Chester for a day out and see the historic walls and things like that. And sometimes they pop in as far as the ship in Hambridge. And of course, when Fred started talking to him about America and things like that, before you knew where you are, Fred was involved and you were talking to him, and people was coming. And, well, I mean, one thing faced another. And this was it. He seemed to know what was going on and who was coming over here to box and things like that, you know. And it was marvellous. And it was, you see, like, when I was still at Newton School when I was a kid, there was there was an American serviceman married a girl who lived in Western Approach. And they had a fruit shop in Ermine Road. And things like that, you see. It was nothing like... My father had friends who were GIs. And, I mean, I was used as a guinea pig, as I said, when, over with penicillin when they were going to take my legs off. Well, I used to get... some toys at Christmas. Nobody else had toys because everything was fashioned and the war was on. I mean, a lot of people don't realise this, but it was actually 1954 before the rationing actually was stopped in England. There was still things on ration in
1954. Yeah.
Yeah. You see, on things, I get sometimes toys at Christmas and I'll never forget, I forgot all about it until I read in the paper earlier this year about the Colorado Beetle. Now, I remember once a load of, there was some food sent from the American somewhere, used to get some food now and again, with me being a guinea pig and this and the other. And of course, there was some given out at school as well. That I don't know how it's come about, but everybody got in the classroom and was given to the school. Then they called it in because there's something about the Colorado Beetles, but it was too late to hand in. It had all gone. But nobody had any ill effects. I don't know what had happened to the Colorado Beetle, but... you know, things like that. I remember that now.
Penicillin, but didn't you pick the penicillin, wasn't you? Yeah, you told me that.
Yeah. But
the polio.
You know, when you think of these fighters now, that they're just names that people look, you know, and I can visualize Larry Baker fighting Mick Leary as I'm talking to you. I can feel, you know, it was a marvellous thing. There was, every round was close. Sportsmanship was out of this world. These people were class act. You know, it's all right saying, okay, it was always better in the past, you're getting old, you know. No, give credit where it's due. The sportsmanship was spot on. You see, when I was down in Cornwall, I got married when I was working in Cornwall for Monks and on an NATO base, actually. it was supposed to be top secret. It was actually what you call igloos, some of it, was where they kept atomic weapons over. It's a St. Morgan Air Base that actually the runway virtually went right over from the cliffs. And I was working there. I was boxing for Truro at the time, Battle Wizards Club. He had a very good son called Bobby with us. He was a good lad. And another lad, his same name was Worldwide Heavyweight Champion Bob Foster. And he was a good lad as well. And when we went to Lawlston one day, and there was an old fellow told us about this fight that broke out, actually guns used with the black American servicemen and some military policemen. Apparently they'd kick some black American pingo that said he wasn't allowed in the pub or something, and apparently these lads had gone back and got into the armory in a bit of a gunfight took place. And apparently the same thing happened at Bamber Bridge, similar. And they, you see, apparently they wouldn't let the whites, some of the white servicemen didn't want the black servicemen being the same bar as them. And these MPs went and at one pub, not in Launceston, somewhere else, and asked them, would he segregate them? He said, certainly. So what he done after, he said only black PIs allowed in. And when he went down there, you know, these sort of things happened. And I was surprised because I'd never heard of this. And now there's been a book written within the Daily Express yesterday about it and about different things that went on. Well, you could understand how some of these boxers, how they were treated definitely in this country and in Europe, like Sugar Ray was idolised. Sugar Ray Robinson and others were idolised in France before he won the middleweight title. And, you know, when he won it and things like that. You know, I mean, it's unbelievable. You could understand why they flocked here, because I just didn't know what it was. And I think it was a generation that, because the British servicemen didn't like it when they told these American PIs, saw some coloured PIs, military police saw the some black Americans drink with some off-duty British soldiers, didn't like it. And the British soldiers stuck up for the thing, for the coloured Americans, because they were good company. And when I was working at, again, for Monks on Churnhill Prison, I wasn't in there. I was working on it when they built it. And I found out the same thing had happened at the American base there, that there was trouble in Market Drayton. It might have only been a sleepy little market town, but there were some hard lads there. And when the trouble started, the locals joined in the fracas with the coloured Americans. So what had gone on, I don't know. Apparently there's a lot of resentments about the way the Americans were treated. I think what had happened is the generation that had come back from the First World War, they'd been in the trenches with a lot of the coloured lads from the Commonwealth, and they had a great mutual respect. And I think that that was the difference. I do.
There's been a lot of the British soldiers stuck up for the black American soldiers against the American oppression against them.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I think because there was when there was an open court over a bit of trouble, it had to be an open court because there were British witnesses that the evidence that the British people did swayed the verdict. So it makes you think, doesn't it? I mean, look, you've only got to look at what happened with Martin Luther King. A lot of these democracies, the democracy is up to a point. You know, I mean, it's just the same as this country over the Windrush. The way that those people come over here to help this country, you know, when we're short of these people in the National Health Service and all that. Yeah. And let's have it right. It wasn't very nice for that. Like Vernon Van Riel, he won the Southern Area title, boxed for it or something. Now, I remember in boxing, what a crowd pleaser he was. The entertainer, they called it. He went over to thing. He got kicked out. He's back now. I should think so. You know, I mean...
Yes.
You know, we'll be, let's have it right. I mean, you see, half the time, we don't know half the time what these politicians are up to. It's just the same as this Cummings. Now, don't get me wrong, you might be right. 250 mile away to take his kid there. It's not saying much. It's not saying much for the country or the government. He's got to take his kid 250 miles to get it looked after, is it? Hey?
Yeah, exactly.
And you've got the other one, the other clown, the fella on the old housing committee. He took his mother's or his family's medication there, then went to his second home. Who's he kidding? If my missus, who's retired with me, can get her medication delivered, you're not telling me a cabinet minister doesn't. Who the fuck do you think they're kidding? If you're having a go, have a go. Do as I do, don't do as I say. You know, that's the way I look at it. You know, I mean, to be honest, you've only got to look at Johnson. Don't get me wrong. There's a man in the background. He promised he was going to get Brexit done. Whether you agree with this or not, right? The man in the background, he's got rid of two prime ministers, Cameron and May. He hasn't even got a voice in Parliament. Is Boris Johnson, he better deliver his Brexit, because he might be number three. That's the way you've got to look at it. Very much like the Arty Towns. Never mind what he's right hand, he can put his baby with the left hand too. That's the way I look at it.
Yeah,
the politicians are all right.
Yeah. Are you dropped a couple
of their own fucking nets, that's all.
Absolutely, yeah, definitely. You dropped a couple in there, so I'm working on a NATO.
Oh, you've got to drop them in now and again.
Yeah. You say a few things there. Every time I speak to you, you drop something in that I could ask you about. I mean, that's a story in itself, working at a NATO base, top secret. But we'll go back to that one. Don't worry about that.
You used to let me use it in my dinner time to train at the dinner time at the NATO base.
All right.
Yeah.
We'll
let me train.
That's another the stories of Tommy Dix that's going to go in. But before we finish this one, Tom, and we spoke speaking in about it's like the first one of this series of, you know, unknown forgotten boxers, if you like. And
funny enough, we were talking about Jimmy Wilde and Peerless Jim Driscoll, Johnny Basham, and I got to know him all from Charlie Milestone. And Charlie Milestone's you've come up with some. Well, Charlie had a hell of a lot more fights than that. But what I'm saying is this, that when you look about this, that, you know, Johnny Basham and people like that thought the great Ted could lose three times and all this, European champion and this. Actually, it's one of the old Bill when he fought for the European title is on there. He's on the wall at the Venture Boxing Club.
Yeah.
And also, on that bill, is a man by the name of Jack Heldman, who used to bandage Fred Tilston's hands and was also a referee. Mm-hmm. He was doing four rounds or something. It just shows you, doesn't it, eh? Small world.
Absolutely. Well, Johnny Basham and Fred Tilson are going to be in the next series when we do. We're going to speak about them.
Well, one
some others as well, aren't we?
One I'm going to do, but is I wanted to we'll talk about. There's one man as well. There's all Bojack and Freddie Dawson. Now, also. Is Charlie Douglas and Teddy Wright, because what a career they had in Italy. And Teddy Wright, a lot of people say that Emil Griffiths, which is dual champion, middleweight and welterweight, but he also won a version that was accepted in Europe of the light middleweight title, world title, when he beat Teddy Wright. Now, Teddy Wright was no pushover for anybody, and neither was Charlie Douglas. And when you see these people, when you look at the record and you think that people say, I've never heard of them. But when they were in their prime, they were something. I mean, I always say this, that it takes a lot of guts for anybody, amateur or pro, to step in a ring. And when you see that these people, the likes we're talking about, Jimmy King, Garty Town, Baby Day, would go anywhere and fight the local heroes in their own backyard, that makes them somewhat special.
Definitely,
Tom. In my book.
Well, in the next one, we're going to do Johnny Basham, Fred Tilson, Bojack, Charlie Douglas, and Teddy Wright. So, with some great.
I'll tell you, I'll leave it until how that. What really put me in good books with the Yanks, with the Americans. It was over. I'll come out with a saying, and I still do, that Fred Tilson used to say. We're spending a lot of time with him. Things rub off, and I come out with this saying, and Stan Hoffman took me up on it, and before I knew it, I was accepted by him. Okay.
Is that the... God, tell us what it is, that, Tom, before he signs the donuts. Is that the one?
That's the saying... I'm dimes to donuts. And Stan Hoffman said to me, that guy's not a limey. He said, where do you get that from? I said, the old fellow had a lot to do with me. I said, I used to say it. And he said, he said, what was his name? I said, Freddie Tilston. I said, lightweight boxers. I've heard of him, he said. And straight away, I couldn't go wrong with Hector Rocker, Al Gavin, and everybody. In fact, Peter Maylard, we went to a show in Holland, and Hoffman was outside, and Peter Maylard said, is Tommy Dix here? Of all the people to see. And Stan Hoffman said, and Stan Hoffman brought him to me at the I was with John Hyland and Billy, John Hyland, Steve Hyland, Neil Monroe, and Billy Moran. and John Isle, and he drove Peter Mayle out to see me. He said, you're up sitting down with us for inside. It's small world, isn't it? All through saying down to donuts. Right?
It's the donuts.
I'll never be able to repay for that.
You've told me a lot about Fred, and it's a great story, and it was an amazing friendship. So in the next one, Tommy, we're gonna speak about Fred, his career, and your relationship with him.
I'll tell you one thing. You'll have to ask Mick Edwards, and I'll bring Eddie Waters over to tell you about when Fred struck one of the so-called hard cases away. Because Eddie Waters done a bit of scrapping, and he said it was the best knockout punch he'd ever seen. I'm not kidding you. I'm Fred, he must have been at his peak then, about 68. You know?
Go on, Tom, give us a preview for the Fred Tilson, the next show with Fred. Tell us that story about when he landed that left up.
What's that?
The left up Fred landed on that hard case in the pub.
Well, what happened was this. It was Christmas, and it was Christmas. I was in the Grosvenor Arms, in what we call clubbies. Eddie Waters, I don't think Eddie should have been in what he was in. And, you know, because of his age. And Mick Edwards, there was a few of us there, and this fella come bouncing in. He said, oh, this is where all the big hitters. This is where all the big hitters hang out. Is it before? Well, before anything could happen, but old Fred, bang, touch for that, the right hand flew in, and the fella went face first down. I've only ever seen a couple get up when they go down face first. It was definitely a bucket of water job. Yeah, for all he got. But he's a different fella after. He never even opened his mouth once after. Oh, well. The last thing, you know what? I'll just tell you one thing. The last thing that leaves the puncher is his punch. And I'll tell you another thing. There's an old saying, I always say, that a few would better go, or going to be a bit mouthy, son, whatever you do, don't miss, because I can't afford to. I'll tell you this, mate, you might be old, you might be slow, but you're still tricky.
Tommy,
the
lovely way to end today's one.
Okay, so, I hope it goes on a light, but I couldn't do justice to how great a fighter is Baby Days, Artie Town, and Jimmy King and Larry Baker. They were somewhere else.
Absolutely. Forgotten boxers, you know, who we don't forget.
Oh, yeah. And when you read about, you know, when Benny Dawson, Morris, what a star. And some of them, like Artie Town, there was riots in New York. He got caught up in them. And he died in the riot. A man like that. You know.
Yeah, we didn't speak about that, did we? We
died. You know, I don't know what went on, but I think I couldn't see him being dead. He must have been just in the wrong place at the wrong time, because he was a gentleman. But they all were. You know. They're great people. To be honest, I'm nearly shedding tears thinking of how fortunate I've been to see these people. It's unbelievable. To be honest, when I walked down those steps to that gym in the basement at the Reliance Works, the journey that Fred Pickering put me on is unbelievable. Okay, all right.
Tommy, thank you, and I feel privileged to be able to speak to you and you pass these stories on to us. And
okay,
you know, so thanks for that. God bless you.
Okay, bye.
Bye, Tom.